want a queen on every continent, so I could escape the government, flee my residence, settle in. I'm militant minded, brilliant rhyme whiz. The time is now for me to shine. Kids are innocent, blinded. Society gotta be reminded of my diary, because tragically I carry the misery of centuries that sent to me, not coincidentally, intentionally, because mentally I represent the key. But it's a double-edged sword, see, trying to be godly, it's hard, especially in poverty's backyard, where violence is taking over. Free enterprise and lies is idolized, cause you're deep inside. Without a law, go to Jehovah, to guide the lost tribe. You're forced to reside on the north side. Babylon is never penalized for being offside. So many lost lives. I wonder how long before the herd dies. The day I heard the earth cry for the first time, it was the worst time. It was the worst time. Yeah. The way I heard the earth cry.
I came to the shores of America. The sky that's a peddler, the Alpha and Omega, and the home of the beggars, the black settlers, who've been beaten, raped, lynched, robbed, and stoned, and called upon the earth for service so they couldn't maintain it home. This dates back to 1555, when they captured the first tribe of men and piled them in a pen 50 feet high, and took them all on a 9,000 mile ride, and landed on the shore of a place they'd never seen before. We read about this inside the ancient books of war. Finders in stainless steel, stripped of their language, still survived the anguish of slavery, but still remain nameless. Separated to portions and tricked by John Horty Hawkins, and sold on the auction, taught birth control and abortion. Rulers of the first part became slaves of the worst part. The devil's curse God and reverse God, and turned God to dog and made people search hard. No relief came to the prophet by W.D. Farrar. Taught trauma, dropped our mamas off in Bahamas and Barbados. Tobagos separated us from slave boats, made our own brothers hate us, from Virgin Isle to Jamaica, Trinidad, Honduras, Haiti, Grenada, Bermuda to Cayman, mental enslavement, you black gods become awakened. At night time,
you can hear the earth cry, how many more black gods gotta die, but we realize there's no God in the sky, the devil tricked us, that's the worst lie. At night time, you can hear the earth cry, how many more black gods gotta die. You realize there's no God in the sky. The devil tricked us, that's the roach lie.
Peace, God, for real, not a spook nor a ghost. Not unseen, but seen and heard most of all. I'm God, control nine planets. Wisdom revolves around me, understand it. Science, my rhyme's underrated. Pyramids building according to how we made it to be. Many shall come, few shall be chosen. 32 degrees below zero when you're frozen. Power refinement, my rhyme's assignment is to crush negative bullshit in the line with the fusion. Cause that which is beyond 360 degrees is an illusion. Either you're deaf, dumb, or blind. Super hypocritical, dumb, 85, yo, it's time. T.I. without me don't exist. God's sight for love divine is what I miss. Checking like a visual reflection, sort of supernatural. You know your mind, our text is being natural. Ultra gamma, the hammers, my energy compressed to a form of a threat for my enemies. Cypher's a circle that consists of a whole. No beginning, no ends, no size, it's just a whole. Like in an event, I'm a percent. Dealt out 100, I'm 5, my degree is a black belt. Real genuine, not authentic.
The first 20 arrived in Jamestown, Virginia in 1619 with the English, not as slaves. That wouldn't take place until more than 40 years later. Actually, the very first Africans had arrived in 1512 with the Spaniards. And as amazing as it sounds today, in a country thoroughly indoctrinated in race and racism, relations between blacks and whites started out in a climate free of racial considerations. This statement may sound foreign today because the version of history handed down in American textbooks is essentially his story. Not only has the history of blacks in America become a new market with growing potential, but the new interest and awareness has brought with it a rededicated search for the truth. The response to Roots showed that blacks and whites are ready to accept American history, not a racial version of his story. However, it's an altogether human tendency to evaluate the opinions of others in the light of one's own priorities. This tendency has, throughout civilization, determined the relationships between individuals, groups, and between nations. Each has presumed his own opinions to be correct and has consequently used those opinions as a yardstick with which to gauge the wisdom of others and to maintain group power and advantage. Racial relations in America is a particular victim of this phenomenon. An incomplete American history has created us and them, of partisanship and opposing sides. An American history that has largely left Afro-Americans out and frequently misrepresented them when it did not, has conversely made facts of such myths as George Washington and the cherry tree, which was concocted by Parson Weems. The list of distortions is long. This is no attempt either to portray all blacks in modern day history as saints. Rather, the assumption is that blacks are basically just like whites. A few geniuses, mostly average, with a liberal sprinkling of fools. Therefore, what is normally called black history, according to Dr. Carter G. Woodson, is merely a missing segment of world history, or the missing pages. In 1915, Dr. Woodson founded the Association for the Study of Negro Life and History. In 1926, he was instrumental in establishing Negro History Week. Today, this national observance has been expanded to include the full month of February to climax the study of black people throughout the year. The association has published a new 10-volume library with such do-you-knows as Three Black Heroes of the Revolutionary War and What Black Man Invented the Traffic Light. But when it comes to the question of how does this search affect blacks and whites and the relationship of the two, you talk to Lerone Bennett, Jr., senior editor of Ebony Magazine and author of the historical classic Before the Mayflower. What are we talking about when we talk about history as we know it in this society?
Today, unfortunately, we're talking generally about lies agreed upon, you know. We're talking about hysteria which has been put together ignoring the contributions of most of the people of the world. Most of the people of the world are colored. And so, unfortunately, we've gotten into a thing of trying to interpret history from a European perspective, from a white perspective. In America, we talk about American history, and we're talking generally about white American history. And I've said often, you know, that we glibly talk about American history, but American history, in fact, does not exist yet and will not exist until we go back to the beginning and take the contributions of black people, of the Native Americans, the Indians, and of white Americans, and blend them together into one great story of what happened in this country.
What is that great story?
It's a story of struggle, oppression, struggle for liberation, but it's also the story of the participation in the building of this country of black people, brown people, and red people at a dimension which are never hinted at in American textbooks. For example, the fact that a black man founded the city of Chicago.
Lerone Bennett is referring to Jean-Baptiste Dusable, who died in 1818, the year his state, Illinois, joined the Union. But for the father of Chicago, there is no park, bridge, or street named for him. There is, however, the Dusable High School.
Knowledge, the source of power, and now a new source of knowledge, a true source of power.
Maybe that's what this Knowledge is Power announcement of the Afro-American Life and History Association wants to correct, among other inaccuracies.
There's a tendency, Tony, as you know, everywhere, to think of black history as some little intellectual ghetto, some slum that we can deal with one week a month.
Tracing black culture from its African roots through the long periods of struggle into the triumphant rights movement to its worldwide influence today, every aspect of Afro-American life is detailed, from literature to athletics, from medicine to art, music, and theater. The International Library of Afro-American Life and History.
It is impossible for white Americans to understand themselves without some understanding of black Americans.
You owe it to yourself, to your family, to your future.
Then on the individual level, you can think of little-known facts the fact that Hiram Thomas, Saratoga chef, created a potato chip. Augustus Jackson, a Philadelphia confectioner, who was known as the man who invented ice cream. George Grant, the golf tee. Lewis Howard Latimer, the incandescent light bulb, the first invented and patented, the first incandescent light bulb with a carbon filament. Charles Drew, the separation and preservation of blood plasma. Many, many of these things which I had generally known. The millions of white Americans and the millions of black Americans who suffer from arthritis or who suffer from glaucoma should thank God that black people came this way. They should thank God specifically for Percy Julian, whose work in synthesizing a drug made it possible for drugs to be delivered at a reasonable price to all these people who suffer from arthritis. George Washington Carver. We could go on and on. These facts generally do not appear in American textbooks. And because they don't appear in American textbooks, Americans, generally speaking, are tremendously ignorant of who they are and of what has happened to them in this country.
We, as black historians especially, when we are looking at a textbook to see whether it's suitable for use in our classes, one of the first things we do is go to the index and look under blacks, Afro-Americans, Negroes, what have you, and then turn to those pages and note the treatment. And we notice increasingly additional information concerning blacks in the textbooks. And of course, we are writing more history, more people are interested in black history.
Dr. Charles Simmons is chairman of Norfolk State College's history department and is an expert on what was left out of history.
There are numerous things that fit that category. For example, the fact that there were blacks possibly in the crews of Columbus's ships, seldom mentioned. One of the first people to set foot on the southern part of what is now the United States, from Florida, Alabama, Mississippi, Texas, Louisiana, across there, was a black man. That was not mentioned, seldom mentioned. This is a Stebanico, who was part of an expedition which made that journey. And to move through history there, we could write a textbook on what was omitted about blacks down to the period of the 1960s.
Indeed, the literary and historical contributions of blacks have been systematically left out of the nation's textbooks. The textbook is an influential tool in the school. It shapes a child's opinions about nations, events, his race, and other races. A child will attempt to assimilate 32,000 textbook pages during his elementary and high school years, about 75% of his classroom work, and about 90% of his homework centers on the textbook. Considering this, a child's attitudes are shaped by the material he reads. Thus, if a child never reads about the literature written by blacks, then it is logical for him to assume that blacks have never written poetry, drama, fiction, or nonfiction. Dr. Ogle Burks Duff, director of the General Assistance Center on School Desegregation and Conflict at the University of Pittsburgh, examined 14 American literature anthologies used in the 11th grade English classes to determine the degree of visibility of the black experience as a part of the American experience in our literary heritage. In the collection, The American Experience, Dr. Duff examined four areas: drama, fiction, nonfiction, and poetry. The volume on poetry contains 186 selections. There are only four by blacks, two by Phyllis Wheatley, an early black poet of the colonial period, and two by Gwendolyn Brooks. Omitted were Paul Laurence Dunbar, who was the first black poet after Phyllis Wheatley to gain national recognition, James Weldon Johnson, Claude McKay, Conti Cullen, and Langston Hughes, who wrote I Too Sing America. The volume on drama consisted of five modern plays by five leading playwrights. There were no representations by black writers. William Wells Brown's The Escape or A Leap to Freedom, the first play written in America by a black, was left out. So was Langston Hughes, who had the most successful and enduring career of any black playwright and wrote plays for over 30 years. Contemporary black playwrights like Lorraine Hansberry and Ossie Davis were excluded as a group. The fiction section traces the development of the short story from Irving and Cooper to contemporary writers. Out of 29 selections, only one was by a black, Ralph Ellison. A child reading this section would assume that blacks were not writing anything of artistic value until Ralph Ellison wrote Flying Home. No mention is made of Charles W. Chestnut, who wrote Gopher Grapevine. His works were judged by the critics of his day. Paul Laurence Dunbar was another contributor to this period. He wrote The Scapegoat, and from 1893 to 1905 produced four volumes of short stories and a series of five short stories in Lippincott's monthly magazine. Richard Wright's Fate and Bigger Thomas was excluded, along with W.E.B. Du Bois' Dreams. The nonfiction section thematically explored two questions: what does it mean to be an American, and what is America's destiny? Out of 64 selections, only three essays were included by blacks, one by Frederick Douglass and two by James Baldwin. Langston Hughes, Benjamin Banneker, Booker T. Washington, and William Wells Brown are also missing pages from the question, what does it mean to be an American? This man certainly cannot be blamed for leaving anything out of history. He's J.A. Rogers, and his books sent chills up the spines of establishment historians. His idea was to denounce the idea of race, other than, of course, the human race.
I think J.A. Rogers was a very important voice in the dialogue of black history. I see him within the context of a whole great tradition. I see him within the context of the tradition of George Williams and Carter Woodson and W.B. Du Bois and William Leo Hansberry, who created this great tradition at which Rogers extended in several, I think, unique and very valuable ways. First of all, I think Rogers extended this tradition in carrying it to the barbershops, to the streets. People in barbershops, as you know, in our lifetime, discussed J.A. Rogers. They argued about J.A. Rogers. They became aware of that history through J.A. Rogers in many ways that they would not become aware of it in an academic textbook. He also extended that tradition in paying proper attention, I think, to the great black men of Africa, to the great inventions black people made in other cultures other than in American cultures.
J.A. Rogers' research on civilizations such as Western Europe, Egypt, Rome, and Greece turned up evidence of African ancestry in many a household name, who by current laws and customs would be black. J.A. Rogers researched subjects such as America's five Negro presidents and concluded that Abraham Lincoln, Thomas Jefferson, Warren G. Harding, and Andrew Jackson had at least one-eighth African ancestry. He claimed that this portrait of Queen Charlotte Sophia, consort of George III, clearly shows an African strain. That this picture of Ludwig Beethoven shows what his friends referred to as his Negroid features. That the illustrious Alexander Dumas Sr., who produced more literature than anyone who ever lived, earned during the mid-19th century the equivalent of $10 million in today's currency as a novelist, was black. He did for French history what Sir Walter Scott had done for Scottish history. Dumas Sr. is best known in America for his famous works, The Three Musketeers, The Count of Monte Cristo, and The Black Tulip.
One of the missions of history is to serve as a memory of a people. See, if you were cut off now with no memory of your past, you would be lost. And a people are in the same position, and so is a nation. And we can use history to support the personality of a people. And history is a source of pride and respect. And many historians exaggerate and use history. For example, I was in Spain a few years ago and discovered that in Spanish textbooks, the Spanish-American War didn't occur. You know, in our textbook, it's there. And of course, you read about the Soviet Union and its use of history. Russia won the war. Soviet Union won the war.
The general idea, of course, is that black people came here as slaves, they were enchained, and black people have always been enslaved in this country. But the fact is that the first blacks came to this country pretty much the same way the first whites came to this country. In other words, the first 20 or so blacks who arrived at Jamestown in 1619 were not slaves, they were indentured servants. And some of them worked out the terms of their indentures and were freed. They accumulated huge plantations in Virginia in this interim period between 1619 and roughly 1660. The evidence indicates that they held some whites in indentured servitude, that they imported some whites. So for a short period, 40, 50, 60 years in this country, black people interacted with whites on the basis of relative equality. A second fact growing out of this is that white people did not come to this country the way that most white people think they came. Most white people in the beginning came here pretty much the same way as most blacks came here. That is to say, they came as unfree people, as indentured servants. White people were kidnapped on the streets of London and Bristol and transported in ships, which were pretty close to slave ships, to America, where they were held in servitude for hundreds of years. White women were whipped in the fields, were chained.
Many of the whites had been so eager to get out of England that they became indentured servants for a number of years. Others were convicts who chose slavery in the new colonies to hanging. The first 20 blacks who landed in 1619 were forced into indentured servitude, just as most whites. But slavery was reserved for convicted criminals. Ironically, Captain John Smith, third president of Virginia, was an escaped slave. Benjamin Franklin complained that England and Germany were emptying their jails in America. Consequently, the United States had a very poor reputation abroad. When President Thomas Jefferson offered free land to any European nation for a legation, none accepted. This entire period was very cruel and oppressive. If poor whites ran away, they were branded on the cheek with the letter R. Irishmen were not allowed to land in Massachusetts. Quakers were tortured. Baptist Jews and Catholics were persecuted. Although it seems unbelievable today, blacks were among the slave owners. Some bought white people in America as early as the 1640s. This shows that in earliest America, there was equal treatment for whites and blacks according to class. Obviously, the first Virginians did not regard blacks as a race of slaves. Black masters in the South weren't any kinder to their slaves than the white ones. Some were worse. They also fought with the Confederacy to keep slavery as an institution. Slavery was a big business, undergirded by a religious belief that said that blacks and Indians were pagans, and it was God's will for Christians to enslave them. At that time, Christian and white were synonymous. Georgia, named for King George II, in 1732 was founded by persecuted whites, many of whom had been slaves. The population of 2,000 consisted mostly of English, German Lutherans, Italians, Swiss, Portuguese, and Jews. They had rejected slavery, but after 29 years of failure to develop economically, had to choose between abandoning the colony or bringing in Africans as slaves. They reversed their religious philosophy and rationalized that the Bible showed that slavery was approved by God. With the rise of white racism, whose real aim was to justify enslavement of the blacks in the 1660s, America took the early lead in trade. This development prompted J.A. Rogers to name this book Africa's Gift to America. He writes that America's trade in molasses led to her economic independence and subsequent domination of world commerce. Molasses meant rum, and rum was used for the exchange of Africans. Rogers concluded that it was the slave trade that laid the financial foundation of the United States. He called it Africa's great gift to America.
We had no large international pressure groups available to us at that time. We didn't have nations nearby that you had to placate. And the labor supply of blacks seemed inexhaustible at that time.
One of the primary movements today is the desegregation of the schools. Particular interest is given to racial quotas to ensure that black, brown, red, and white students will share a common cultural experience. But how can they until desegregation applies to the curriculum and particularly the textbooks? If a white child learns in history and literature classes only the personalities and events shaped by whites and their European forebears, how can he or she help but feel a sense of pride in his or her own race? But all the white child has learned of blacks is that they're nuisances, obsessed with protests, civil rights, and affirmative action. None or very little is told of their role in building and shaping America's destiny. There is no basis for respect. The black child's problem is obvious. He's always looking over the shoulder of the real Americans, the people who count, and they aren't black. Dr. Carter G. Woodson wrote in The Miseducation of the Negro, "When you determine what a man shall think, you do not have to concern yourself with what he will do. If you make a man feel inferior, you do not have to compel him to accept an inferior status, for he will seek it himself. If there is no back door, his very nature will demand one. Only when history replaces his story will we have a foundation for meaningful racial relations and a viable desegregation of our society. However, history is on our side. No lie has ever survived, and truth crushed to the earth shall rise again. It already has."